compared to the old one or the existing one by rejecting the null hypothesis set by you. Both the tests are equally effective. So for that, when you apply a certain test, for that purpose I am saying that it is two statistical formulas, a statistical technique, and each formula contains a standard error of that statistic in the denominator. If the standard error is very less in your data, you are going to have a bigger value of that statistic, and if you have a bigger value of the statistic, you are going to reject this, because you might have heard that at the 5% level of significance, the t value so-called is 1.96 or the z value is so-called 1.96. So if you are able to get a value greater than 1.96, you say that you are going to reject the null hypothesis at such and such significance level. So if you are going to reject the null hypothesis, ultimately you have attained your goal and you will be able to say that the neutral is more efficient. So this is the way how confidence limits are prepared. Though the package will give you all the things, but you have a nutshell and idea, and you can see whether your results are really correct or not. Now this is I have written, so many times you have come across these things, p-value and its interpretation. What does this p-value means? Let me tell you in a very simple non-statistical way. P is a probability, so it's the probability and under the null hypothesis. This is a probability under the null hypothesis. Suppose your null hypothesis is both the tests are effective. So it is the probability of rejecting our null hypothesis set by us. If it is less, we say that since the probability is very less, we are rejecting the hypothesis. Otherwise, statistically, it has a different interpretation. What we say that P is the probability of obtaining the extreme values of the statistics. The statistics, I mean, if the drug is tested through t-test, suppose, and T is has some formula, so T has a certain value. So P is the probability of getting a higher value of T under the assumption of the null value. In other words, we say P is the probability under the null hypothesis of rejecting null hypothesis. So if it is very small, we reject the null hypothesis. That's why when the P is less than, see, if P is less than, you take this P is less than 0.05. Many of the times you come across this situation. In all papers and everywhere, it is written P is less than 0.05. So we say that if P is less than 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis. Because this 0.05 is very less probability. It's only 5%. So your 5% probability is there of rejecting the null hypothesis, you reject the null hypothesis. This probability is very less in terms of, is less in terms of to obtain higher value of T. So we reject the null hypothesis, and in this particular case, when the P lies between 0.05 and 0.01, 0.01 to 0.05, if P exists, these days every paper requires, Mr. Jain is sitting here, we generally prefer to have the exact P values. So if the exact P value is there and P lies between 0.01 to 0.05, we say that the moderately evidence against S0 is obtained. But if it is less than 0.01, see, though the null hypothesis is rejected and you are getting your new drug to be effective, but we say that it is a very strong evidence against S0 for the rejection of the S0. So these are the criteria of rejecting, and this is the logically meaning of the p-value, which is very common in analyzing the statistical data in any respect, whether it is a clinical trial or it is a any survey or any medical study. Health study. Next study. I have already explained next study. Now, so in clinical trial, you have two groups. Ultimate goal is to see the difference between the two groups. One is the experimental group and the other is the control group. Control group may be the placebo or may be the traditional existing drug. You wanted to see. See, in this, both the groups are independent. One group has an intervention and one group has not an intervention. You see, these are independent groups. For analyzing these type of data, we always apply t-test. There is a test called t-test which sees the difference between the two groups which are independent. Independent means the subjects which are allotted in the control group are different to the subjects which are allotted into the experimental group. So we applied details, how to apply, what is the formula, that is the material, so all packages are there. Ultimately formula is there, the same formula is applied, P is given on the basis of the same criteria. If P is less than 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis, and our null hypothesis also in that particular case is the mean value of the, both the group are same. So this is the way how, this is most common technique which is applied in the clinical trial. But many times it happens, like I think in the chikungunya or this influenza trial, they come across, they have somebody came that if you are looking for the doses or the effect of the new new medicines before and after values. Suppose some surgery is going, and before the surgery you have noted up certain parameters, and after the surgery you wanted to see whether they have come down or not, like cholesterol or anything you can think about in the case of the cardio. In that type of data, even if you have two groups and you wanted to see within the groups these type of differences also, we apply the t-test, but it is called the pair t-test. Pair t-test, before and after, we have to take the difference, we have to consider the difference of the before and after values, and then apply the t-test, and it is something little bit different from the independent t-test, and we say that it is a t-test is applied. But t-test is applied in the case when you have a continuous data. But as I told you, many of the times you have a qualitative data or you have categorical data, the same thing can be attained by applying the chi-square test. So we apply there the chi-square test. In chi-square test, see, in the chi-square test, you have a 2x2 table, or depending upon the categories, 3x3 or 2x4, whatever may be the case. Here I have taken a 2x2 table where it says the new drug and the standard drug and improvement. So through chi-square we say that the association is significant and the new drug is effective. It indirectly tests the proportion of the cure rate in new drug as compared to the standard drug. For though we applied the chi-square gives the difference between the two proportions. But if the data is qualitative, and the same thing can be attained through a t-test if the data is continuous, and there we apply a t-test, and the interpretation is same. But in the case of the pair observations, I told you the pair t-test is applied. And on the other hand, if the data is qualitative and the observations are paired, we say that, and if there are only two categories, then only the next MacMillan chi-square test is applied, which is based on the number of concordant and anti-discordant pair. Concordant means before and after means same effect, and the discordant means before it is negative, after it becomes positive, or before it is positive, after it becomes negative, that type of thing become a discordant, and we say that it's a discordant pair, and the analysis is based on the discordant pair. So these are the few techniques which are generally applicable in the case of clinical trials. Next slide, please. I have already covered. And you must have heard ANOVA, the analysis of variance. So suppose if there is only two groups, you can apply the t-test. But many times if you have more intervention groups, and simultaneously you wanted to compare the more interventional groups, then in that case, if the groups are independent, we apply ANOVA technique, analysis of variance. So simultaneously, it gives all the groups wherever the significant difference appears, and to see which particular group is there, all software packages, there is a critical value available. If the mean difference of the critical value is less than that, we say that the group 1 or 2 is significant, or 2 or 3 is significant. So such type of thing is available. Next slide, please. Now, these are all the parametric tests so far I have discussed. Though many times we say that the chi-square is a non-parametric test. As you remember, in the beginning I told that if you have in more than 30 observations, you say that your data is normal distribution. Or if you have a very large sample, many times to see the normalcy, there are certain normal tests are applied or you can see from the mean median distance, mean median and mode, and you can see the data is normal. Sometimes it happens in the practical practice that the data is not normal. When data is not normal, these tests are not applicable, and if somebody buys these tests, the results are not to be correct, and you are doubtful whether the findings of the trial is correct or not. In that case, the same test is applied through a different way, and that is called the non-parametric test, where there is no distribution of the function is required. They don't have any distribution, and no the data do not follow the normalcy condition. So there are certain tests which are there in the non-parametric also to see the difference between the two groups, like Wilcoxon random test. See, in the non-parametric case, when you have a smaller size of data, we generally calculate the statistic based on the ranks. So we calculate the rank, and then we see the difference between the sum of the ranks. So this is it. I'm just telling you, make you aware that such type of thing is there in the non-parametric. So these tests, the same t-test where you are applying for the independent group, here you apply Wilcoxon rank sum test. We pull the data, both the groups, we make out the ascending and descending order, we calculate the ranks, and we take the sum of the ranks, and again there is like a t-formula for the two mean upon the standard error of the difference of the mean. We have for the sum of the ranks, and we see that the whether the sum of the ranks is significant or not, and on the basis of that, we draw the inference.
Next slide, please.
That's I just wanted to say, these are very, in a nutshell, very important and commonly used techniques when the data of the clinical, any clinical trial is being analyzed, and these are the very small points I have told you, which a clinician should be aware that such type of things are here whenever you discuss the things with any of these statisticians. So this is, thank you. Anything you wanted to ask?
That should be analyzed each center-wise, or it should be pulled at one place and then it has to be analyzed.
See, in multi-centering trial, what is there, data should be analyzed at one center. That is a different thing. See, there are five centers, and it is in the protocol itself, at the planning stage itself, we decide whether the pool data is something different to the data analyzed at this one center, and the center is identified. Now, as regards to each center, you can analyze. There is no harm to see the center-wise results. But at a particular place also, where the facilities or the infrastructure is available, a good statistician is there, you have a software, data can be analyzed even at the center-wise. Now, the difference of the centers may require, because there is a center difference also, lab differences also, and beside that, statistical differences, the two appears in the different centers. So it all depends upon the objective of the trial, what exactly you want. It can be within the center, between the center, lot of analysis can be done. And wherever you get a fruitful findings of the trial, you can analyze the data set. That will give, suppose your trial is conducted at five centers, and you wanted to see, and you have two groups only. One is the intervention, another is the experimental. And you wanted, and each center you have collected 50-50 observations. You will pool the data, you will get to 50 observations. Now you can say that the data is normal distribution, and all the normal tests will be applied. You can do the analysis as one single data set. And if you wanted to see the difference between the two drafts, the same thing will be applied. T-test will be applied, independent t-test, and you can say, but from the same data, within the center, if you wanted to say at this particular center, what is the effect of the drug? What is the points which cause them to be non-significant? In multi-centric trial, many times it happens, the results at one center is significant. In very rare cases, the results has a different pattern and they are different, non-significant at one center. And if you wanted to identify what are the reasons for the non-significant, you have to analyze the data in different. And many times you can cross-check the data if you have very small sample size. By applying independent parametric test in the pooled data, the non-parametric test for the independent data.
So, but there is no hard and fast rule as such.
So, in the protocol can be done?
Yes, but that you have to decide at the beforehand, at the planning stage, that if our finding is like that, we will modify the this. In what way you will modify your protocol? Not in the exclusion or the inclusion criteria. You can modify your protocol in the what will be the sample size, you will go on time period. Since you are not able to get the sample, you say that I will increase my trial from 1 year to 2 year, 2 year to 3 year, like this. So it all depends. But you can. That's why we have a interim analysis at the planning stage.
In our studies, we don't have the control in the clinical trial. So how these tests will be applied to that?
If you don't have the control and you have only one group, then the same type of analysis, depending upon the objective, it's an observational study. More important is the observational study. This is an observational study. Then you can only take out the mean, standard deviation, and this. This is one way. But in the within a group, you can also nest it your data. Like you can say that within a data, within a one group, you wanted to see the sex differential, whether there is any male versus female difference appears. So in the one group only, you can do the same type of analysis, and that is called nested. Like sex wise, age wise, less than 50, greater than 50, less than 50 become one group and greater than 50 become second group. Again you have within a group, again you have two groups.
In such cases, can we go
baseline is, if you wanted to compare from the baseline, the same, you might be having a data of the same person after some effect.
Yes.
In that case, you have a paired t-test.
Paired
t-test.
Paired. In our clinical trial, we have a baseline, but they are not control study, but they are observational study, but we have a baseline data.
If the baseline data you have and you are comparing with the existing one, and if the subjects are different, you can apply with the independent t. But as I told, if you have the subjects are same, it's a before and after observation. Before surgery, you have taken some observation on one particular person, and after surgery, then in that case, you have to apply a paired t-test. Like this, they brought me the data, and she has applied paired t-test, while independent t-test is to be applied. So in that case, the findings may be referred. Thank you.
There are some data where the qualitative data we have scored them. So that is already there in the protocol, how we have scored them. So in that case, which method we have to use for analysis that type of information?
See, again, this type of data becomes a categorical data. The scaling you have given, but for analysis purpose, it is a categorical. Now it all depends, there are different ways to analyze this categorical data, what exactly you want. Suppose you wanted to get an agreement, whatever score you have given, there are two techniques. You have given a scoring with your own, and somebody else has given a scoring through some other way, and you wanted to have an aggregate agreement. How correct you are in giving such type of scoring, whether your scoring system is matching or not, we say that the Part-5 is applied. But if you just wanted to see the difference between the scoring of the one group and the scoring of the second group, or the scoring of the one variable to the other variable, we applied the test differently. That is also proportion test, or the say we also say the Kaiser. But Kaiser is for proportion. It is a different, it is not a 2 by 2. It's a something different. They are all different tests are.
I was just thinking about the marginal homogeneity test for this scoring kind of information. That is also a non-parametric test we use for this.
Yes. See, homogeneity means same. Variability should be less. So if there is small data set is there, so you are see, you can yourself can think, if you have 1,000 observations, you can't rank them. And as the sample size increases, you might be seeing that naturally the variability between the data decreases. So that distribution, if you plot theoretically, let me explain. If you plot that data, you will find that automatically that curve will come like this. It's a following normal distribution. So if the normal distribution data is following, you have to apply the normal distribution test, t-test. Whether it is scaling or not, there are different techniques available. Log linear, marginal distributed, or this. These techniques are available.
Something like, suppose we have 100% and 50% got improved and 50% did not respond. If we take out the mean, it means the result will be zero.
No, the thing is, I told you, you have to decide how you are going to interpret your missing values. Okay, that means what you wanted to say, if I have correctly followed you, you have suppose 100 observations, 50 have improved, 50 not improved is an observation, but more information is there, this value is something different. What you are saying, it is not improved?
Not improved.
Oh, efficacy of the drug is very less than you would have. See, the cure rate in both the thing is same, improved and not improved. Then you have to see improved and not improved in what respect. It's not only one point.
To control method we are applying. We are using control method.
Huh, it's okay. So in a not improved means, 50% improvement is not improved. The rest of them are not improved. So the efficacy, you have to calculate the efficacy. Efficacy is very less. If efficacy is very less, you must think that the drug is better. Suppose you have you are comparing this efficacy but with what? Not improved and improved name. Both the P and Q, they are related. If suppose the improvement rate is 60%, naturally the non-improvement is 40%. You are not comparing 60% with 40. What you are comparing is 50% of the improvement with the new drug with some base value or with some control value, the control without the medicine or the placebo, how much is the cure rate or whatever the medicine is. In that way, sometimes if the data is very large, this may appear. The difference may come out to be significant. But if the difference is not significant, then you can't say that your new drug is effective.
Generally, we say that it is 50%. Improvement is 50% or did not respond 50%.
See, did not respond 50% is something different. See, did not respond, what do you mean? But you have to explain this. That's why we said that there is a two-way communication between the clinician and the statistician. See, here is an example. You are saying 50% not improved.
Not
improved is an information. But not responded is an information. Not responded in what way? And not available is an information, but we have to see what exactly it is. Suppose, let me give you an example to make it more clear. Suppose you have 100 observations. And you have information on the 60 cell, remaining 40 are empty. That is missing value. Value is not available. Whatever may be the reason, patient has not turned up, you have not entered, whatever may be the things. Somebody has not entered, that is it. There are techniques to fill up those missing values. But not responding is a technique that means your medicine is not effective, that's why it is not responding. This is all depends. Okay.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for informative lecture. Thank you once again. Now I request Professor P.P. Mangla. He is a retired Dean of Faculty of Arts, University of Delhi. He is the youngest professor at the age of 36, entered in the University of Delhi. He is a member of various important committees. He is also a member of Knowledge Commission Committee. I request him to speak on information dissemination to research.
It does not mean that you are writing science. And the question comes, why do you write?
So the other people who are writing here, the research.
And why do you read it?
More important.
That's the way you look at it. And why the need of introducing these things in discussion? Because writing is a process. Certainly, it's a world of communication. I think if you look at the background of any living person or living being, I put it, he communicates. Whether an animal or a human being. If you look into the whole history of human society, the biggest achievement of the human society has been that human society wants to communicate. You're walking on the road, a policeman on the crossing shows his hand and stops the traffic. He's communicating. You are sitting with your friends, you shake your hand like this, or you nod your head like this, you are communicating. So communication is part of life. Look at animals. It is considered to be that when there is a danger in the jungle, there is a sort of a sound the animals make, communicating that there is a danger in the whole area and be ready to take action. When they see a hunter, very often you will find, hunters will tell you that the moment they see someone who is coming to kill some animals, animals make a sort of a noise which indicates that please take shelter, some danger is there. But the difference is that human mind not only thinks in a rational manner. And he has the better developed organ of communication. That's the only difference between man and animal. And then if you study the whole history of communication, you find that if there was no language, look at the earliest part. The man started communicating. He didn't have the language. He started drawing pictures in the jungles, on the caves, paintings, in order to express his ideas, which could be recorded. And that's the whole process of development of human system of communication. In the ancient civilization, when you look at it, you find there are paintings, there are drawings on the old caves. There are foot impressions. They all communicate some information to you. With the passage of time, man started feeling, particularly if you are living in a small town, a small village, in a small place, the man-to-man communication, person-to-person communication is easy. But when you are scattered, you are living in different parts of the area, how do you communicate? One thing could be that you walk all the way to communicate with Mr. X and Mr. Y. And Mr. X and Y come to communicate to you by walking or by other means. It was in that direction you find, if you study the whole history of human civilization, the biggest achievement of human mind is to create a wheel. Have you ever thought about it? If there was no wheel, you could hardly think of the modern world. Transportation. It is in that direction when the need arose. The human mind started thinking of not only developing some better techniques of communication, but also putting their ideas in a more organized manner. And this led to what you have, the modern language. You have the art of writing. And also in it themselves, they would not have been sufficient until and unless you had developed a medium on which to write. I'll not like to go into that part. Being a student of history myself, I would have been happy to talk to a group like this maybe in a different section. That when you look at the whole history of medium of writing, you come across the tree leaves, the bark of the trees, the skin of the animals, you come across clay tablets, even now you find pottery and other things. Look at the whole civilization of Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa, Indus Valley civilization, where inscriptions are there on clay tablets. If my dear friends ever get a chance to look at the ancient mode of communication, go to some library. Look at the sort of medium which was used in order to write and write what even today. The language used in Indus Valley civilization has not been deciphered properly. But that was the language. The shortcoming is with us and not with those people who communicated. It is in that cause the whole civilization started to grow. And then you come across today a world where the world is nothing but world of communication and a world of publication. But I think the 21st century is a century. I'll call it as a century of communication. Everyone is trying to communicate. Man-to-man communication was the ancient phenomenon. You get up in the morning, put your television on, and what are they communicating? They are telling something to you. The whole world of advertising today is nothing but a system of communication. If you look at the script, as I said earlier, drawing pictures and others, look at the script of the Chinese, the Japanese. It's a pictorial script because they were drawing pictures and photographs and drawings, and it is on the basis of that script they have evolved. But in the Chinese script, and there is no letter. Each letter indicates a concept. So you are in a world where the whole world is different, and the world where communication through writing is a process, and the world where you are communicating not only through writing but also non-writing medium. It is in that context I feel that you should look at the whole thing in that particular context. When I look at the title of it, seminar like this, it should have been taken very easy that anyone can write anything but one wants to write what is very scientific about it. Dr. Sharma, being an editor of a journal in our NISCA, would have discussed about it. I'll say a few essential components of a good writing. After all, you are writing what? You are writing your research findings. So even if you are writing a story, you are writing a fiction, the whole process of thinking is involved. Have you come across in your discussion the last one or two days certain terminology? Because writing includes the paper and the bibliography. In the beginning, the title, the abstract, the introduction to the paper, the text of the whole theme, that is the main thrust. And then you come to the conclusion. Then you put a bibliography. And if everything has been done, you will also add tables, statistical data, as she was talking about. You may even put some photographs. It is in that context, if everything has been done in a proper manner, you feel that you have contributed something which is not only conveying what you want to convey, but also giving a situation when somebody wants to read. If you write something and nobody reads, it has no value. The whole need for scientific writing is that it is not a matter of satisfaction to yourself only, but it should be also a matter of interest to the person who is looking into it. If he looks at the paper and says, it's all right, forget about it, you have lost the whole value of writing a good paper. In that context, I'll look at it, I'll emphasize that. Choosing the title of a paper is something very crucial in the whole process of writing. If you have chosen your title properly, people say 50% work is done, I still feel 50% work has been done properly. It need not be verbose. It should communicate what you are trying to say. It need not be just giving an impression under high-sounding terminology which neither you understand nor I, the other man understands. I'll give an example. In the modern system of management, while you can use all these terminologies which are important, monitoring, cost-effective, cost-benefit, they are very important terminologies. They communicate what you want to say in a more precise manner. But at the same time, please be careful that you do not overload your title with a terminology which, instead of communicating properly, is creating a sort of a noise in communication. I'll give an example. I was chairman of the research board of Delhi University. I'll come across very often the titles of this proposed research programs for PhD. I was looking after 33 departments in 5 faculties: arts, social sciences, management, mathematics, and education. Very often we'll come across a title which had to be reworded and properly worded. Somebody was writing a book the other day. The title he put was Women's Participation in Development of Panchayats for Developmental Purposes. Communicates what the man wants to write. But is it the title which should be of a paper where you will find some attraction, a sense of readability among the users? It has to be precise. And then, colon, a critical study. With my experience, I have found the word critical absolutely has no meaning in any research program when you put the title. If you say study in itself means a study cannot be studied until and unless if it is not critical. If I say women's participation in panchayat system, this is how I deduce it. And then it says W-O-N-E-N apostrophe S, women's. I think, my dear young man, if I just say women participation, will it not be sufficient? Being a young man, I'll be very happy to communicate. He's tried to communicate. I say, suppose I put it here, women participation in development in panchayat system in Haryana, a study. After all, if the study is there, it must have looked into what is the role of panchayat. panchayat in the developmental activity, the socio-economic development of Haryana state, and what the panchayat system has been doing, that is implied. You can put that sort of information maybe in your introduction, that you are putting the sort of a delimitation like this. You are not going into various other aspects, excepting the socio-economic aspects, and in that particular context that will be communicating what you want to say. But why do you unnecessarily overburden the title of your thesis or overburden the title of your book, which may not communicate what you want to communicate? Instead of 15 words, we reduced it to 8 words. And I felt, and I still feel, and he came to me later on, and he said, "Sir, it communicates what he wanted to say in a more direct manner and need not." Is it a pressy? Is it a review? As I said, English language is enormous. In Hindi, I think they call it what? Sar. How do you like to differentiate between this? Because then after all, somebody will go and tell, "I have attended the course on technical writing," and they say, "All right, now since you know how to write a good paper and how to write an abstract," certainly the expectation will be a little higher from the side of the editors of the journals, as they will expect a good abstract to be prepared, presuming that you know what is an abstract. Without going into the details, I'll say in a simple way that an abstract is not a summary. Summary is supposed to be a little longer version. If the article is 10 pages, somebody usually expects that to write at least 3 pages. An abstract may be 100 words. It need not be critical. An abstract is an honest and true representation. I'll underline the word honest. I'll underline the word true. It is an honest and true representation of the thought contents of the original in a condensed and even abbreviated manner. In abbreviated. That is what it is. If you start making writing comments, "Oh my, I have given this paper and the paper is among the one of the best papers and this and that," in the abstract, instead of writing in the text, you start praising a few things about yourself in the abstract itself, it is not an abstract. The emphasis is only on the contents. The purpose is very clear. It gives you at a glance what the whole thing is about. Now there are different types of abstract. I'll not go into that part in a group like this. I'll only mention two types. Pardon? Forget about structured abstract. These are the terminologies. The modern world is a world of computer science. They always give you a new terminology to the old concepts. That's a wonderful world. I'm searching for the data, and here comes a computer science man and tells, "Oh, we are mining the data." I said, "Yeah, I'm looking into the storehouse of information." And, "Oh, professor, you have introduced many terminologies, but why don't you use that? We are looking into the warehouse of information." Structured is something which the computer scientist has used, where it does not apply his mind. A computer, and I'll not go to that part because that leads us in a different direction.
a computer, my dear friends, the computer scientist has introduced enormous vocabulary to our language, which makes you think. But a computer is only a tool. It is not a substitute for human thinking. And this is where our problem will go. The abstract has, I'll put them in a broad way for authors like you, potential authors like you, I'll put only two types of abstracts. One is the indicative abstract, and the other is the descriptive abstract. Indicative gives the boundary lines what has been discussed in the article. It may say, the article deals with the research conducted at so and so. The findings have been listed and a few things more. It does not go much into the text. It only indicates what the topic is about and how has it been dealt with in the article. A descriptive abstract is a little longer. Will also give you details about the findings and even mention something about the conclusion. But these are, as I said earlier, an honest and true representations. No criticism, no praise, nothing. But it contains. And that's very important. Now the purpose is very simple. An abstract helps you in deciding as a user whether you should look into the article or not, whether you should read the article or not. It helps you in choosing your reading. It helps you in selecting your material. If I give you 100 articles, a journal comes to you, and you feel that you would like to select some articles which are of interest to you, you cannot go and reading and scanning through the whole article, all journal issues. The best thing is that you look at the abstract and it gives you a sort of a bird's eye view what the article is about. The author's name are there, they help you in deciding the credibility of the article. And if their names, in addition to their names, their status has been mentioned, it helps. These are all part of technical writing. If it is descriptive, it helps you even sometime in using the descriptive abstract as a substitute for the original when you don't want to read the original. Number three, a very important element. The article has been written in a language not known to you. The abstract has been prepared in a language along with the original language, in a language which is known to you. You can still make use of the article by reading the abstract in the language which is known to you. Give an example. We used to have this problem, we continue to have this problem. There are many scientific articles written in Russian language. Then we started a process that let the abstract also be, in addition to the abstract written by the author himself, an abstract in English. And the user can look into the abstract in English if he is looking into the descriptive abstract, it is all right. And he feels nothing more is needed, if he now wants to read the original, he can ask for the article in Russian to be translated in English for him. It's in the context of process of communication. An abstract can be written normally by the author, but I'll mention there are certain journals, indexing journals, where the abstract can be prepared by the subject specialists and by others. It is considered to be that author, if he is honest, he writes a good abstract, it can be depended upon. the other element I don't have to go into. Introduction, the text of the whole article, and the conclusion. And my dear friends, when you are writing the text of the article, a very important element after choosing the right title is to put a subheading. And that subheading is involving your thought process. You are able to say what subject heading, subheading is to be used. And when the moment you are able to decide your subheading, your whole paragraph is geared to that particular line of thinking and you don't deviate from the original. And sometimes good authors even write, give the numbering, 3, 3.1, 3.2 as the subdivision and so on. And particularly in medical sciences, you find this is a very common phenomenon. When I come to the language, certainly an author should have the complete control over the language. I'll give an example. If you look into scientific world, is easier that way. Because when I talk to mathematical people and even physicists and others, their way of looking at it is different because it is a scientific article, need not be having verbosity. But still, a complete control on the terminology is must. Use the proper terminology to communicate what you want to communicate, and it need not be in a complicated manner. I'll give an example. The other day, we were having some discussion on environmental studies. It was very cold outside. I said, could you just go and see outside the window how the environment is? The gentleman comes and says, I have done the environmental auditing, sir, and it is pleasant. I said, young man, if you had told me that you have looked at the environment outside and it is pleasant, that would have been easier for me to understand. What is this environmental auditing terminology you are using to impress us? It does not communicate what you want to communicate. Although you have used the terminology, because auditing is a word again which has become very popular with the young people, and they use this terminology even sometimes understanding where the need is. I was sharing the session 2 days back in the CSIR to select people, to promote people, and a young girl comes. I say, where are you working and what has been your position? She says, PME section. That's wonderful. What is PME? Program, monitoring and evaluation. I said, that sounds very well. And I, please explain. Why do the monitoring? I do that monitoring, this project monitoring, and this and that. She almost made us flabbergasted so far as the terminology was concerned. I said, I don't think you understand the word monitoring. What does it mean? Are you the manager? You are controlling? What is that you want to tell? I said, please give an example. She mentioned the project and I was doing monitoring. I said, what were you doing? Let us come to the brass tack of the whole matter. Oh, when the project comes, the report comes to me, I put it. I said, you are putting the whole information in a file, communicating that file to the users, and certainly I feel very happy the word monitoring is being used. It sounds very high, but please don't use the word all the time. This is where I want to tell my dear friends, be little careful in writing. If you look at the language, in my mind, among the English authors in India, I'll rate Pandit Nehru to be superb. Have you ever heard, read any book written by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru?
Letters from Father to Daughter.
Letters. What is the title of the book?
Indira Gandhi when he was in jail. That is one. And now, look at it. The man is writing letters to a young daughter who has to understand what he is writing. He has compressed the world history. My dear friends, if you have not looked into it, look into it. He has compressed the world history in the simplest possible communication system. And still it is very high. Read his Discovery of India. I think among the English authors, I'll rate Pandit Nehru very high. The command over the language, the way he expresses the whole idea. And if you look at another author, where the language flows from the heart, the ideas flow from the heart. And that is Mahatma Gandhi. I'll be happy if you look at these two books. Mahatma Gandhi is that book, well-known book about his experiments with truth. And Pandit Nehru's autobiography, or even his Discovery of India, glimpses of world history. Look at it, that how the language flows. You are tempted to read even if you don't want to read. That's the quality of an author. Very often, today, I even admire Khushwant Singh as an author, as a literary author. He makes you feel with his observations and his communication that you understand what he is meaning and he understands what you want. This is where a very important element in communication system. I'll proceed further and say a few things because I find, I wish I could have a teacher who goes on talking. I'll not like to do that. Now, towards the end of the article, you have to attach a bibliography. I'll put a question to all of you. You must have seen the articles. Some of you have written. What is the difference between a bibliography and a reference?
The bibliography is the part of the
reference book. Thoda careful bataiye hame. What is the difference between a bibliography and a list of references?
Bibliography actually gives names of the books and literature for further study or further reading.
Okay. And references?
References are books.
Pardon?
Exactly the source of material.
All of you agree with him? All of you agree with him or not? Can I agree? References, as the word stands, you are quoting some author's authority or a publication and you are giving reference. And when you are giving a reference, please make the reference citation as clear as possible. Author, now look at the importance of the whole sequence. Author, the title. If it has been published as an article in some journal, name of the journal. After the name of the journal comes the year of publication of the journal, the order of the sequence. And after the year of the journal comes the volume number. Now you want to read it. You want to hear about the year 1955. Now you want to go and see 55 and which volume number. Each journal has a volume number. And if I give the whole volume to you and no pages, it has no meaning. So, after the volume, you must have the pages. In your article, sometimes you may say P152 and sometimes PP152-155. This is what you were saying when you said reference. Bibliography is something which helps
you to proceed further. In this also there is a proper sequence. Author, title, if it is a book, the title of the book. When it is a book, it must give the name of the publisher.
Edition.
Edition, name of the publisher, and the year, and the total number of pages it has. P149 is different from 149P. You understand?
Yes.
Not a full traditional system, but you understand. P149 means page 149, and 149P means the book has 149 pages. If it is an article, the pages of the article, 112-157. P comes last. So this is how the whole thing is has to be rendered. Now in the bibliographical citation and in references, you come across very often two terms which I now try to quote to editor. One term is EBID, I-B-I-D. Have you ever seen it?
Yes.
You have. How many of you have seen it? I-B-I-D. And also, sometime you come across a term, a symbol, OP, full stop, sit, opposite. How many of you have seen such things in your reading articles or even sometimes you are writing articles? I'll say reading articles because many of you would not have used this. EBID, always in italics. Opsit, OP, full stop, CIT. Have you ever come across these two terms? Right. One. Anyone else?
ID.
Two. Come on. Three.
ID.
Four. My dear friends, all of you have done your graduation. That's the sad part of your educational system. I'm saying it in general way. I come from a university which has been now yesterday given 100 crores of rupees as a very special grant, as a center of excellence. Even there we come across these problems. What is EBIT? Who would like to say? Yes. And if it is article, you said book, if it is an article, anyone else? Now this is, you want to say something? This is a way that we will not like to repeat some information unnecessarily.
Is it related to international?
No. In this terminology has been in usage for hundreds of years. Internet is only yesterday's creation. EBIT, now you have written, given a citation. I'll take a citation, let us say, from Shakespeare. Shakespeare, William, then the title of the book, author, and then page 142. Okay? It's the citation. Citation number 11. It could be a reference, it could be a bibliography. I'll primarily say it's in the context of reference. I'll now come to item, next item. It is 15. I want to quote it again. Maybe different page, but the author and title are the same. I have two options. Either to repeat the whole citation again and then say page 16 or page whatever it is, or I just say EBIT and give the exact page from where the reference has been taken. EBIT stands here as the earlier one. Clear? It helps you. you in saving time. It helps the user to understand you are not an illiterate man to write article. And these are standard terminologies. Now in the context of opposite, opposite means already cited. Now you have given reference number 15. William Shakespeare, this and that. 16, 17, 18 are different. 19 again is the same document. So instead of repeating at 19 again, you say opposite means already quoted. Shakespeare, William, opposite, page, so and so. Am I clear? Answers to you, Varmaji?
Yes, sir.
So then some of these articles in your research journals, and then have a look at them. How opposite and EBIT have been. EBIT is immediately following. 15 item, William Shakespeare, so and so, page 49. Item number 16, exactly the same. I don't have to say the name of the author again. I'll just say EBIT and the difference in the page number from where it has been quoted. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Just a minute. I'll explain to you. Yes. EBIT is clear?
Yes.
Opposite. William Shakespeare, page, item number 15. 16, 17, 18 are different. 19 again comes and we want to quote William Shakespeare again. At that stage I will say Shakespeare, William, opposite, page so and so. This means William Shakespeare which has already been quoted. Now, you were saying? Example. Let us say here, you are talking of EBIT.
No, sir, this is opposite.
Opposite? Item number 4. Okay? Item number 4 is Jawaharlal Nehru, Discovery of India. Page 59. Okay? And writing a history item, article, or you are writing. In medical science, you could quote an author. 16th is something, 17th is something, 18th is different, they are different. Again, I come to 19, and I find Pandit Nehru's book is to be quoted again. So I say here, Nehru, Jawaharlal, opposite. Nehru already quoted earlier, on 15th. And now in 19th, I don't have to repeat. I say here already quoted, but quoted Nehru. Which book already quoted? And page so and so.
If there are more than 2 to 3 books of same author, Nehru.
See again, you have, then you define.